بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه أما بعد. This is our fifth lesson going through the poem Al-Shatibiyya, authored by Al-Shatibi. Alhamdulillah, we have arrived at Surah Umm al-Quran. Now we know that Umm al-Quran is referring to the mother of the Quran, which is Surah Al-Fatiha. And the reason why the author brought this chapter pertaining to Surah Al-Fatiha here, right after Bab al-Basmalah, is because generally when a person begins the recitation of the Quran or he begins the khatmah, he begins with the isti'adha and then the basmalah and then Surah Umm al-Quran, Surah al-Fatiha, which is why the author brought it here. Whereas usually Surah al-Fatiha will be put under the second part of the poem, which is the farsh. Remember that the poem is divided into two sections, usul and farsh. Usul are those qawa'id, those principles that occur throughout the Quran, right? Like the rulings pertaining to al-imalah and the rulings pertaining to the hamazat, and the rulings pertaining to Al-Mad wal-Qasr, and the rulings pertaining to Al-Waqf, and the rulings of Ya'at Idhafa and Ya'at Zawa'id, and so on. These are the rulings pertaining to the Idgham. These are principles and qawa'id that occur throughout the Qur'an, repetitively. As opposed to the Farsh, where you have special differences on certain cases or certain words in the Qur'an al-Kareem, but it's not something that occurs throughout the Qur'an in most cases, which is why we have these two separate points, the Farsh and the Usul. Now, we would expect that Surah Umm al-Quran be the first part of the Farsh. But the author brought it here, right after Bab al-Basmalah, because usually when a person begins reciting the Quran, he begins with the Isti'adha, and then the Basmalah, and then Surah al-Fatiha. When he's beginning a Khatmah, they begin from Surah al-Fatiha, and then work their way down to Surah al-Nas. So the first part of this chapter, the author says, وَمَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ رَاوِيهِ نَاصِرٌ. And so here he mentions, and we explained this line in our introduction, so we should know it by now, that the harf which is differed upon is the word Malik, Malik Yawm al-Din. And those who recited it like that, and of course, وَبِاللَّفْظِ أَسْتَغْنِي عَنِ الْقَيْدِ إِنْ جَلَى, he didn't mention to us the Qayd, because it's extremely clear that those who recited it as Malik Yawm al-Din with the affirmation of the Alif is رَاوِيهِ نَاصِرٌ Allah رَمْزِ الْكِسَائِ النُّون رَمْزْ عَاصِمْ. So عَاصِمْ الْكِسَائِ say Malik Yawm al-Din, as opposed to Al-Baqoon, the remaining Qurra, right, which will be Nafi' ibn Kathir, Abu Amr ibn Amir and Hamza. They recite it with the removal of the alif, and this can be either termed as al-hadf or al-qasr, right? And so you can say Maliki Yawmiddin, get rid of the alif for the remaining qurra. And so Nafi' ibn Kathir, Abu Amr ibn Amir and Hamza, they will say Maliki Yawmiddin. Asim and Kisa'i will say Maliki Yawmiddin. Then the author says, وعند سراط والسراط لقنبلا بحيث أتى والصاد زاين شمها لدى خلف وشمم لخلاد لولا. Here the author mentions four rulings, three explicitly and one you will have to know from the ضد. Although here the author applies the qaida we mentioned, وباللفظ أستغني عن القيد إن جلا. Right, and so because the ruling is explicitly clear, the fourth ruling, which is the opposite, it will be understood and you don't need to know the qayd for it. طيب, the author mentioned وَعِنْدَ سِرَاطٍ وَالسِّرَاطِ لِقُنْبُلَ بِحَيْثُ أَتَى, meaning that قُنْبُل, wherever he finds the word sirat, when it is in the state of a nakira, meaning there is no لَامُ التَّعْرِيفِ in front of it, or when it is مُعَرَّفٌ بِأَلْ, like السِّرَاط, you recite it with a seen, and they both occurred in Surah Al-Fatiha, and it's not just restricted to Surah Al-Fatiha, بَلْ بِحَيْثُ أَتَى, wherever it comes in the Qur'an. مَثَلًا in Surah Al-Fatiha, صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ, you recite it with seen for قُنْبُل, you say صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ. Likewise, you say اِهْدِينَ الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ, be seen, not with صَاد, فَهُ قُنْبُل. And this is not just restated to Surah Al-Fatiha, but بِحَيْثُ أَتَى, wherever these two words come in the Qur'an. And when we say صِرَاط and as-sirat, it's not just these two specific ones, but there might be a كَافُ الْمُخَاطَبَ attached to it, or a يَاءُ الْمُتَكَلِّمَ attached to it, right? It doesn't matter. The حُكُم still applies. And so مثلا Surah Al-An'am, you will say what? وَأَنَّ هَذَا سِرَاطِي سِرَاطِي مُسْتَغِيمَ بِالسِّين فَقُنْبُلْ. Likewise, you say what? سِرَاطَكَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ سِرَاطَكَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. Likewise, you say سِرَاطِ اللَّهِ الَّذِي لَهُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Right? السِّرَاطِ السِّرَاطِ. right? So whether it is mu'arraf or غير mu'arraf, the word sirat, you recite it with a seen, however it comes in the Quran, for qunbul. That's the first ruling. The second ruling, the author then says, وَالصَّادَ زَيَّنَ شِمَّهَا لَدَى خَلَفٍ. So the second hukum is that when it comes to the word sirat and as-sirat, instead of reciting it with the seen like we did for qunbul, recite it with a sad, which is mixed with the zay, right? Ishmam al-sadi, salt al-zay. You do what an ishmam, a mixing together of the sad into, or of the sound of the sad into the sound of the zay, such that it becomes like the Egyptian va. Of course, with maintaining the isti'la and the itbaq upon, which are of course sifat for the letter sad. And so you say, ihdina al-zirat al-mustaqim. زراط الذين زراط الذين وأن هذا زراطي مستقيمة. And this is again بحيث أتى, however it comes in the Quran, be it in سورة الفاتحة or not سورة الفاتحة. You say what? زراطك المستقيم زراطك المستقيم. This is for who? خلف عن حمزة خلف عن حمزة. So that's the statement of the author. والصاد زاين شمها لدى خلفين. That's the second ruling. The third ruling, the author then says, وَشْمِمْ لِخَلَّادِ لَوَّلَا. Khalad agrees with حُكْمُ al-ishmam upon these two words only in the first scenario that it comes in the Qur'an al-Kareem. And that is in قَوْلُ اللَّهِ جَلَّ ذِكْرُهُ اِهْدِينَ الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. Therefore, Khalad is restrictive, whereas Khalaf is not restrictive. Khalad restricts the ishmam to the first mawdi' of Surah Al-Fatiha only. And so he only does the ishmam on the first sirat that he finds in the Quran. Everywhere else he is in the camp of those who were not mentioned in these lines, and they are the camp of the remaining qurra who recite the word as-sirat and sirat with a sad, a pure sad. طيب. And so here the third ruling is for Khalad. You recite with Ishmam, As-Sad, Sawt al-Zay only in the first mawdi'. And so you say, Ihdina al-Zirat al-Mustaqim, Sirat al-Ladina an'amta alayhum, wa anna hadha sirati, siratak al-Mustaqim, sirati Allahi alladhi lahu ma fi al-Samawati wa ma fi al-Ard. طيب, that's how you are going to recite it for Khalad. The only time where you do ishmam is in the first mawdi'. Everywhere else it's done with a pure sad. And as for the remaining qurra, Nafi' ibn Nafi' al-Bazzi, right? Remember, qunbul goes into the first ruling, which is to recite the sirat and the sirat with a seen. وَعِنْدَ سِرَاطٍ وَالسِّرَاطِ لِقُنْبُلَ بِحَيْثُ أَتَى. So therefore we have Nafi' al-Bazzi, Abu Amr ibn Amir, Asim, and al-Kisai. They have, wherever you find the word sirat and al-sirat, you recite it with a pure sad. And so we have four camps here. The camp of Nafi' al-Bazzi, Abu Amr ibn Amir, Asim al-Kisai. They recite with a pure sad on these two words, however it comes in the Quran. Then you have the camp of Qunbul, who recites those two words with a seen, however they come in the Quran. Then the third camp is the camp of Khalaf, who recites with Ishmam al-Sad, Sawt al-Zay, wherever it comes in the Quran. And then you have Khalad, who only does this hukum that we had for Khalaf. He restricts it to the first mawdi' faqat. And so he says, اِهْدِينَ الزِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. However, the remaining mawdi', he is like the first camp. He recites it with a pure sad. Wallahu a'lam. Then الشاطبي says, عَلَيْهِمْ إِلَيْهِمْ حَمْزَةٌ وَلَدَيْهِمُ جَمِيعًا بِضَمِّ الْهَاءِ وَقُفًا وَمَوْصِلًا. Here the author mentions that these three words, عَلَيْهِمْ إِلَيْهِمْ and لَدَيْهِمْ, wherever you find them in the Quran, which is why he said jami'an, i.e. fi jami'il mawadi', recite with a dhamma upon the ha, whether you are stopping on the word or whether you are continuing with the next word. طيب, however you find it in the Quran, you recite it with a dhamma upon the ha. And so you say, صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. You recite with dhamma upon the ha, right? You say عليهم, right? Likewise, you say إليهم, right? Likewise, you say وما كنت لديهم إذ يلقون أقلامهم أيهم يكفل مريم لديهم وما كنت لديهم إذ يختصمون, right? إذ أرسلنا إليهم اثنين إليهم لديهم right عليهم right عليهم الكتاب مثلا طيب you recite with a dhamma upon the ha whether you are stopping on it like صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم or whether you're continuing صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين طيب likewise وما كنت لديهم إذ أجمعوا أمرهم وهم يمكرون okay that's how you read it for who for Hamza recites with dhammah upon the ha in عليهم إليهم and لديهم be it وصلا أو وقفا wherever it occurs in the Quran. As for the remaining Qurra, then they recite with a kasrah upon the ha. They recite it with a kasrah upon the ha. They say alayhim and ilayhim and ladayhim. طيب. And this is taken from these three words, and this is a general principle. Of course, we'll see some exceptions when we have the case of alayhim and ilayhim coming before a sakin, we will see inshallah the madhab of al-Kisa'i. But for now, we will take the general qa'idah that the author mentioned here in that Hamza recites alayhim, ilayhim, and ladayhim with a dhamma upon viha, waslan, and waqfa.
Then the author spends the rest of the chapter discussing the masail pertaining to mim al-jama', the plural mim. What is mim al-jama'? Mim al-jam' is an extra meme that denotes plurality. For example, the word alayhim. This meme, if you were to get rid of it, it would read alayhi. Alayhi means upon him, singular, right? Whereas when you put the meme, it will show what plurality, alayhim, upon them. And so it's an extra meme, meaning you can get rid of it. It's not part of the building blocks of the word, right? Unlike مثلاً alimun. Here, in the word alim, the meme is a letter which is asli, meaning if you were to get rid of it, the word would change. Okay? And so, alayhim, here the meme is known as meme al-jama'. Likewise, the meme al-jama', it can come before a vowel letter. For example, مثلاً alayhim غيري. So here, this meme, al-jama', comes before a vowel letter. And it can also come before a sakin. For example, ilayhim uthnain. إليهم اثنين إليهم اثنين right likewise مثلا بهم الأسباب بهم الأسباب right عليهم القتال here it's coming before a vowelless letter a second and a third point to note is that when we consider the ميم الجمع we only consider the ميم الجمع that occurs at the end of a word not within a word for example مثلا أنلزمكموها أنلزمكموها this meme here This meme here is meme al-jama', but it is within a word, not at the end of the word, which is why you see the sila being affirmed for all of the qurra. All of the qurra will say anulzimukumuha, right? Asqaynakumuhu wa ma antum. طيب. Wallahu a'lam. So let's discuss the first scenario in which we have a plural meme occurring before a vowel letter. Like مثلا صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. Here we can see the meme الجمع. What comes after it is a non-hamza. And you can also have a hamza coming after it like مثلا سواء عليهم أأنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم لا يؤمنون. طيب. And in both cases they are vowel letters that are coming after the meme الجمع. We have four camps. The first camp is the camp of those who always recite with a dhamma on the meme and then elongate that dhamma to bring out a waw. طيب. And that will be madhab ibn Kathir. The madhab of ibn Kathir. As al-Shatibi mentioned, wasil dhamma meme al-jam'i qabla muharrakin diraka. So if we have a meme al-jam'a and what comes after is a mutaharrik, be it a hamza or a non-hamza, then ibn Kathir will recite with a sila. And so he will say, غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين إن الذين كفروا سواء عليهم أنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم لا يؤمنون طيب هذا المذهب of Ibn Kathir The second camp are those who do not recite with a silah at all. Rather, they keep the mim sakinah, and of course, if it's sakinah, there won't be any waw coming after it. And that's the madhab of the remaining qurra, with the exception of qalun and warsh. With the exception of qalun and warsh, who fall into the camp number 3 and 4 respectively. And so, مثلا حفص, likewise شعبة, so عاصم in total, likewise أبو عمر البصري, likewise ابن عامر, likewise حمزة, likewise الكسائي, right? And of course, when it comes to حمزة, for عليهم إليهم and لديهم, he recites with a ضمة upon the ها, وصلا وقفا, as we took in the previous slides. طيب. And so they will say, صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين سواء عليهم أأنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم لا يؤمنون. No سكون, no ضمة on the meme, and no صلة. طيب. You then have the madhab of قالون, in which he has both أوجه. So the قالون here is unique in that he has his feet in both camps, meaning he has the option of reciting with صلة like Ibn Kathir, and he has the option of not reciting with صلة like the second camp. طيب. As a shalt, we mentioned, وصل ضم ميم الجمع قبل محرك دراكا وقالون بتخييره جلا وقالون بتخييره جلا. And so قالون, he can have the option. And of course, you have to be consistent. So if you're choosing to recite with صلاة, then you remain that consistent upon that. And if you choose to recite without صلاة, then you have to remain consistent upon that. You can't mix them together. So you can't say, مثلا, صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. لا. You have to be consistent. طيب. And so you say either, صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. Or you say, صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. These awjuh are valid for qalun. You then have the fourth and final camp, and that's the camp of warsh. Warsh only does sila if what comes after the mim al-jam' is a hamzat qat'a. As a shart bi majr, min qabli hamz al-qat'a silha li warshihim. ومن قبل همز القطع يصلها لورشهم. طيب. And so they, ورش will say, مثلا صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. Here, because there is no همز قطع coming after the ميم جمع, he will recite just like the camp of the remaining reciters, the second camp. He is like them. He recites it without a صلة and a سكون upon the ميم. However, if what comes after it is a همز قطع, if what comes after the ميم جمع is a همز قطع, then he will recite with a sila and a dhammah on the mim. طيب, like مثلا وَسَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمُ أَنذَرْتَهُمُ أَمْ لَمْ تُنذِرْهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. And we'll see why he elongates the 6 harakat in باب المد والقصر. طيب, what the shahid here is that warsh, if what comes after the mim الجمع is a hamzat qat'a, he recites with the dhammah on the mim and a sila of either well after it. طيب. وسواء عليهم أنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم لا يؤمنون. See, when it came أم لم تنذرهم لا, this meme الجمع, what came after is a lam, and so he doesn't recite with الصلة, and he recites with the سكون upon the meme. However, in the case where it's همزة قطع, he recites with a ضمة on the meme and الصلة after it. And then الشاطبي says, وَأَسْكَنَهَا الْبَاقُونَ بَعْدُ لِتَكْمُلَ. I mean, the remaining قراء recite with a سكون upon the meme, and of course, by necessity, there won't be any صلة once you do سكون upon the meme. And so in these two lines, we can see the summary of what we mentioned in the previous line. So the author, he says, وَصِلْ ضَمَّ مِيمِ الْجَمْعِ قَبْلَ مُحَرَّكٍ دِرَاكَ. So that's the first camp, the camp of Ibn Kathir. وَقَالُونٌ بِتَخِيرِهِ جَلَى. This is the camp of قَالُونَ. ومن قبل همز القطع يصلها لورشهم, the camp of ورش, وأسكن الباقون بعد لتكمل, the camp of the remaining قراء. Looking at the next scenario in which we have the ميم الجمع when it occurs before a ساكن. Now of course this ساكن will always be preceded by a همزة وصل, which is dropped حال الوصل, as we should know. So in here مثلا بهم الأسباب, you have a لام, لام تعريف ساكنة, preceded by همزة وصل, but حال الوصل, the همزة وصل is dropped. Likewise, عليهم القتال. Likewise, وأنتم الأعلون. طيب. Now, when we look at the ميم الجمع, when it is being preceded, or when it is preceding a ساكن, we look at it from three angles. The first angle is if the ميم الجمع is preceded by a ha, which is preceded by a letter that has a كسرة. Like in this case, بهم الأسباب. ميم الجمع preceded by a ha, and this ha is preceded by a ba مكسورة. or a harf which is maksur. The second case, in which you have a mim al-jam' preceded by a ha, again, which is preceded by a ya sakina, which is preceded by a ya sakina. Like in this case, عَلَيْهِمُ الْقِتَلِ the ya is sakina, and then you have a ha, and then you have a mim. And the mim here is mim al-jam'. طيب. And then the third case is all other scenarios, like مِنْهُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ, if the ha is what? Preceded by a sakin, right? Or مَثَلًا وَأَنْتُمُ الْأَعْلَوْنَ, meaning all other cases of mim al-jam' outside of these two special cases. طيب. So you have three cases. The first case is if you have a mim al-jam' preceded by a ha, which is preceded by a letter that is, has a kasra on it. The second case, if which you have a mim al-jam' being preceded by a ha, which is preceded by a sakina, and then all other cases fall under case number 3, or section number 3, and the author discusses all three sections in the next slide. So here الشاطبي mentions, وَمِن دُونِ وَصْلٍ ضَمُّهَا قَبَلَ سَاكِنٍ لِكُلِّنْ. So this is the first madhab, and that is the general madhab for all of the qurra, in which if you have a mim al-jam' and it's preceding a sakin, then the asr is that you should recite the mim al-jam' waslan with a dhammah and no sila. And so you say, وَأَنْتُمُ الْأَعْلَوْنَ وَأَنْتُمُ الْأَعْلَوْنَ. طيب, that's the principle. Likewise, عَلَيْهِمُ الْقِتَالِ عَلَيْهِمُ الْقِتَالِ بِهِمُ الْأَسْبَابِ. That's the asr, that's the principle for all of the qurra. طيب, that you recite the mim al-jam' with a dhammah and no sila. So you don't say وَأَنْتُمُ الْأَعْلَوْنَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْقِتَالِ. لَا. Rather we recite with the ضَمَّة on the meme and no صِلَة. Like that's the general principle. وَمِنْ دُونِ وَصْلٍ ضَمُّهَا قَبْلَ سَاكِنٍ لِكُلِّنْ. Now the author talks about the two other scenarios that you mentioned in the previous slide, where he says وَبَعْدَ الْهَاءِ كَسْرُ فَتَلْعَلَى مَعَ الْكَسْرِ قَبْلَ الْهَاءَ أَوِ الْيَاءِ سَاكِنًا. Abu Amir al-Basri, ayy Fatal Ala al-Zabban al-Ala, he recites a kasrah on the meme. So the asr that we recite with a dhammah on the meme without sila. Abu Amr, in two special cases, he recites with a kasrah on the meme. And this is on the condition that you have before the meme in jam' a ha. And you have before this ha either a ya' sakina or a harf which is maksur. That's why he said, وَبَعْدَ الْهَاءِ كَسْرُ فَتَلْ عَلَى, meaning the meme al-jam' must come after a ha, number one. مَعَ الْكَسْرِ, likewise, this ha must be coming after a harf which is maksur, like in bihim, or a ya sakina, like in عَلَيْهِمْ. In these two cases, Abu Amr al-Wasri, waslan, will recite with a kasrah upon the meme without a silah. And so he will say, عَلَيْهِمِ الْقِتَالِ عَلَيْهِمِ الْقِتَالِ إِلَيْهِمِ اثْنَيْنِ إِلَيْهِمِ اثْنَيْنِ بِهِمِ الْأَسْبَابِ بِهِمِ الْأَسْبَابِ. That's how Abu Amr al-Basri will read it, right? In these two cases, لِكُلِّن, that's the first madhab, in which the principle is to recite with dhamma upon the mim al-jam', if what comes before it, if what comes after it is a sakin. That's the principle for all of the qurra, لِكُلِّن. However, now here we're mentioning some istithna'at. The first istithna' is for Abu Amr al-Basri, if you have a mim al-jam' coming after a ha, and this ha is preceded by either a harf which is maksur or a ya sakina, then in this case we recite with a kasra upon the mim al-jam'. And so we say, عَلَيْهِمِ الْقِتَالِ بِهِمِ الْأَسْبَابِ. And this is of course applied waslan. Then the author said, وَفِي الْوَصْلِ كَسْرُ الْهَاءِ بِالضَّمِّ شَمْلَنَا. وَفِي الْوَصْلِ كَسْرُ الْهَاءِ بِالضَّمِّ شَمْلَنَا. Here now the author mentioned the madhab of Hamza and Kisa'i. The madhab of Hamza and Al-Kisa'i. And this is حال الوصل, they recite with a dhammah upon the ha. So we're talking about the same two scenarios that we did kasra upon the meme for Abu Amr al-Basri. So we had here a meme al-jam' preceded by a ha, preceded by harf maksur, meme al-jam' preceded by a ha, preceded by a sakina. In both of these scenarios, just as Abu Amr al-Basri does dhammah, does kasra upon the meme al-jam', here shamlala, which is Hamza and Kisa'i, they recite with a dhammah on the ha itself. So it's not just a kasra upon the ha, rather it's a dhammah upon the ha. And so they will say, عَلَيْهُمُ الْقِتَالِ عَلَيْهُمُ الْقِتَالِ بِهُمُ الْأَسْبَابِ بِهُمُ الْأَسْبَابِ. And this is of course, حَالَ الْوَصْلِ وَفِي الْوَصْلِ. طيب, وَفِي الْوَصْلِ كَسْرُ الْهَاءِ بِالضَّمِّ شَمْلَلَا. So Hamza and Kisa'i, in the two cases that Abu Amr al-Wasri does kasra upon the mim al-jam', which is on the fact that you have a mim al-jam' coming before a sakin, and before the mim al-jam' is a ha, and before that ha is either a kasra or a ya sakina, Then in this case, Abu Amr al-Basri does kasra upon the meem. إليهم اثنين عليهم القتال بهم الأسباب. طيب. That's the madhab of Abu Amr al-Basri. Hamza and Kisai, in those two same scenario, they recite with a dhammah upon the ha waslan. طيب. And so they will say عليهم القتال إليهم اثنين بهم الأسباب. طيب. That's the madhab of Hamza and al-Kisai. And then the author gave examples by saying كما بهم الأسباب ثم عليهم القتال. Then the author mentioned وقف للكل بالكسر مكملا. However, حال الوقف upon the word عليهم and بهم, you recite with a كسرة upon the ها for all of the قراء. كسرة upon the ها for all of the قراء. And so you say بهم. Of course, حال الوصل for حمزة and الكساء, you say بهم الأسباب. Right, bihumul. Lakin حال الوقف, you recite with the kasra upon the ha. However, remember we mentioned those three words عليهم, إليهم, and لديهم, in which we have to recite for حمزة بالوقف وبالوصل. Whether you're stopping or continuing, you recite those words with a ضمه. Right. So you say here on عليهم القتال. How many قراءات which you have on this case? You will have the قراءة وصلا for أبو عمرو البصري عليهم القتال. The قراءة of حمزة and كسائي, which is going to be waslan with a dhammah on the ha, alayhim al-qital, and then the remaining qurra, alayhim al-qital, kasra upon the ha and dhammah upon the mim, as the author mentioned, biduni wasl dhammuha qabla sakinin. طيب. Okay. Amma hal al-waqf, you will have two qiraat, not one qiraat. Remember here the author mentioned waqif lil kulli bil kasri mukmila, so the, based on this line alone, you would say that all of the qurra will recite with a kasra upon the ha waqfan, and so they also say alayhim. However, alayhim is from those three words that Hamza does not do, that Hamza recites with waslan and waqfa with a dhammah. And so Hamza waslan says alayhim, and waqfan he also says alayhim. And so in this case, alayhim al-qital waqfan, you will have two qiraat, the qira of Hamza alayhim and the qira of the remaining qurra alayhim. But in the case of bihim mathalan, حال الوصل, again three قراءات, أبو عمرو البصري says بهم الأسباب, and then you have حمزة الكسائي say بهم الأسباب, and the remaining قراء say بهم الأسباب. طيب. However, وقفا, all of the قراء agree, and this method comes into play, وقف للكل بالكسر مكملة. Why? Because that's what the author mentioned, and there is no exception that we mentioned in the previous line, because there are only three words in which حمزة does وقفا وصل to recite with a dhamma, and that's عليهم إليهم لديهم, and this word is not عليهم إليهم لديهم, and so we have only one قراءة وقفا, and that's to recite with all of the قراء بكسر الها, and so they all say بهم وقفا. أما وصلا, we have three قراءات, بهم الأسباب for حمزة الكسائي, بهم الأسباب for أبو عمرو البصري, and بهم الأسباب for the remaining قراء. طيب, هذا والله أعلم. With this, we're able to conclude the مباحث pertaining to this chapter. هذا والله أعلم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك, أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت, أستغفرك وأتوب إليك, والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.